Hey Explorers, Brian here. You might be thinking that we're running out of places on the Earth with unique and unforgettable contrasts, but then again, you probably know better by now. East Africa is a study of these contrasts, the world's oldest country and among the world's newest countries. A deep gorge flush with biodiversity not too far away from a barren, sandy, and hot coast. And people who come together for their country and people who fight each other for control. This, my friends, is East Africa. Our objectives today will be to describe the physical characteristics and climate of East Africa, to list the dominant ethnic groups of East Africa, and to identify the unique cultural complex found among the peoples of East Africa. So grab your hat, saddle your camel, they have tons of them here, and let's explore. East Africa is made up of the countries of Sudan, South Sudan, Ethiopia, Eritrea, Djibouti, Somalia, and Somaliland, Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, and Tanzania. I'm not sure if I made a big enough deal about the contradictions of this area before, but keep in mind the word contrast as we proceed through. Before we take off, have a glance at this topographical map of the region. Pause the video here, take a minute, and circle at least four areas on the map from your PDF lesson guide. And if you haven't printed that out yet, perfect time to do so. And use your knowledge as a geographer to predict what people do in that area. With the Red Sea to the north, the Gulf of Aden to the east, and the Indian Ocean to the south, the oh-so-correctly named Horn of Africa has been a strategically important area practically since people started using boats. Also called the Somali Peninsula, the Horn is the fourth largest peninsula in the world and home to the countries of Eritrea, Djibouti, Ethiopia, Somalia, and the contested country of Somaliland. All along the coast and stretching hundreds of miles inland, the climate is hot and dry nearly year-round due to monsoon winds blowing dry air in from the west. For a good part of the year, temperatures across much of the Horn remain around 100 degrees Fahrenheit, and rainfall is practically non-existent. By contrast, the central highlands of Ethiopia, called the Ethiopian Plateau, are far more fertile and can receive up to 80 inches of rainfall per year. Due to this fertility, Ethiopia is one of the oldest inhabited countries, beginning with the Kingdom of Punt more than 5,000 years ago. While essential to Ethiopia, the rains in the highlands provide much of the water for all other Horn countries as well. For example, Somalia has only two permanent rivers, the Juba and the Shebelle, and both flow from the Ethiopian highlands. Pause the video here and head to your lesson guide to answer the following question. Based on what you've just learned, what kind of challenges do you think the Horn of Africa contains for the people and animals that live there? The Great Rift Valley was formed by diverging tectonic plates. You can even see where this has happened by looking at the Red Sea area. The Great Rift Valley in Africa is made up of two large branches, East and West. This pulling apart has created the African Great Lakes, most of which lie near to the Western Valley. However, Lake Victoria, the largest lake in Africa and third largest freshwater lake in the world, and the beginning point of the Nile, lies in between the two branches. Its water is depended upon by Kenya, Ethiopia, Tanzania, and Uganda. Running primarily through the center of Ethiopia and Kenya, the Eastern Rift Valley also has lakes, but almost no outlet points for them. The rift has created many of the high plateaus which dominate central Ethiopia, Kenya, and Tanzania, creating the fertile soil which has allowed for agriculture in the area for thousands of years. In all of these areas, the highland climate tends to be far more temperate, even in Kenya, which lies on the equator. This region is also known for its large parks and preserves, including, in the flat savanna of West Tanzania, the world-famous Serengeti National Park, and Mount Kilimanjaro, the tallest mountain in Africa and a product of the Rift Valley separation on the Kenyan-Tanzanian border. Like Lake Victoria, some of the lakes of the Western Rift Valley are among the largest in the world, such as Lake Tanganyika, which is the second deepest and longest freshwater lake in the world, and contains an estimated 16% of the world's non-frozen freshwater. Sandwiched in between these great bodies of water are the countries of Rwanda and Burundi, and just a little north, the country of Uganda. All three of these countries are subtropical to tropical and heavily influenced by the topography of rift valleys and peaks, with Rwanda even having the nickname Land of a Thousand Hills. What differences could you see in people's daily lives for those who live in the Rift Valley versus those in the Horn? Let's pause here for a moment and answer this question in your PDF lesson guide. South Sudan is primarily tropical rainforest and grasslands, with the exception of a huge swamp called Sud, or the Barrier. Much of Sudan has far more in common with the North African countries than with the rest of East Africa, as most of the country is dominated by the Nubian and Bayuda deserts, which are plagued by haboobs, or giant sandstorms. Let's begin with our North, Central, and Sahelian friends, the Amazighan. Not only in Somalia and Somaliland, but also across Sudan, Ethiopia, and eastern Kenya, the Amazighan, or Amazigh people, can be found. A relative of the Amazighan is the Kushite people. Of these, the Oromo make up a large portion of the Horn's population and also Kenya's, where they account for a third of the population. Another important Kushite people group are the Somalis, a people group which have two countries in this region named for them and have inhabited the Horn region for thousands of years. 18 million people across the Horn are Somali. One of the most impactful historical events on people groups in Africa was an event called the Bantu Migration, which happened around 1000 BCE. Many of the remaining people groups we'll discuss were either a part of that migration or driven by it. The three major people groups of Rwanda and Burundi are the Hutu, the Tutsis, and the Twa. The Hutu are of Bantu descent and are the majority people group in the area, making up almost 84% of the Rwandan population. The Tutsis are a people group which already lived in the area when the Bantu arrived, and after independence became the ruling monarchy over the Hutu for a time. Let's pause quickly to make a prediction that we'll come back to in our next lesson on East Africa. In your learning as a geographer and in your own experiences, what consequences typically occur when a smaller group of people rules over a larger group of people? There are literally hundreds of groups and subgroups throughout Tanzania, central and western Kenya, South Sudan, and Uganda. One thing they have in common is being a part of the Nilotic language group, which is the second largest people group after the Bantu. The Nilotic peoples came to East Africa from the Sud region of South Sudan and spread out across the Rift Valleys, taking on many traditions of their Kushite neighbors and eventually the Bantu people. One of the hallmarks of East Africa is the lingua franca Swahili. A mixture of Bantu and Arabic, Swahili is one of two official languages, the other being English, for six countries of East Africa. An estimated 200 million people in East Africa speak Swahili. While Islam is the majority religion of several countries, Christianity is also widely practiced across the region. Music. Discovered almost a century ago, the Olduvai Gorge is a fossil bed which provides a record of continuous habitation by several human species across a 2-million-year period. If you lived in a region which had been identified as the origin of humanity, would that make you think differently about the ground underneath your feet? Why or why not? Pause the video here and answer in your lesson guide PDF. Kenya and Tanzania are world famous for their overland wildlife trips, called safaris. From mid-June to October, almost 40% of all tourists headed to Africa will make a stop in one of these two countries. They do so for the chance to glimpse giraffes, elephants, lions, zebra, antelope, hyenas, rhinoceroses, crocodiles, and more. For the more adventurous, at 19,340 feet, Mount Kilimanjaro is the tallest mountain in Africa and makes up one of the seven summits, or seven tallest peaks in the world. Bring your coat, though, because while it's a volcano, it's been dormant for thousands of years and it gets pretty cold up there. The unique blend of cultures across East Africa creates a singularly unique opportunity to interact with various cultures and living situations. From Khatmia Mosque in Kassala, Sudan, to spending the day in a Maasai village in Kenya, there are hundreds of culturally connected experiences to be found in East Africa. Before we leave, of the brief tour of locations that we've seen, which would you be most excited to visit and why? Pause here and answer in your PDF. A vast and complex tapestry of geography and humanity come together to form the East African region. While there's much left for us to talk about in our lesson on East Africa's government, economics, and conflicts, we leave our discussion here for now with a promise to keep exploring. Hey!